Olinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Footy Shorts, written by Margaret Clark and read by Mark Mitchell. Be sure to visit our website at www.bolinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Bolinda Audio book releases can be found at the end of this recording. Footy Shorts by Margaret Clark begins with a dedication to Laura with love. Chapter 1.
Stop handballing and kick it up the corridor, yells Dad as I fumble the footy. But our coach has said more handball, so halfway through my handball I try for a kick instead and boot my wrist. And of course the ball goes skidding off sideways and the hyenas get possession. There's a groan from the crowd. If a kid stuffs up in the match, it's the worst. Like, I feel lousy for a week, my guts will be churning, I'm wondering if I'm going to be a legend or a loser in the next week's match. Man up! Man up! A cheetah fan roars. My hyena's little and skinny, which makes it worse. I should be able to stay with him as we charge back down the oval, but he's built of elastic or something, and I reckon he's got a hydrofoil up his arse because he just takes off like he's jet-propelled, leaves me for dead, and does this glorious drop-punt that goes right into the arms of number 14. Their side, naturally. I said man up! Why don't you listen? I'm starting to hate footy. You see, I have to play whether I want to or not, because my great-grandpa played for the Cheetahs, my grandpa did, and so did my dad, and each time they played in the grand final. And we're talking league here because that's where they ended up. The Big Cats won the premiership. Ever since the Cheetahs first kicked a footy back in 1925, the other teams reckoned the Cheetahs always won because they're cheats. Never mind that the rhinos always charge the man and the vultures go for the eyeballs and the hyenas are scavengers and the heelers are complete and utter mongrels. So I'm the fourth generation cheater in our family and the pressure to perform is enormous. You'd think that being brought up in a footy family would be easy, that the talent would be passed down in the genes or something, but mine must be recessive, which means they were lost along the way. I've got the height. Everyone's tall in my family. My dad's huge. Like, he's 108 kilos of mainly muscle and he's 1.9 metres tall. And in his prime, he was versatile on the field. When they put him in the back, he was like a brick wall. When they put him at centre, he just hurled himself into space and tapped the bounce. And at half forward, he wasn't too bad either. A legend to live up to, with 200 goals up before he retired with a permanent knee injury. Whether he was in defence or attack, he was a major factor in the fortunes of the Big Cats. I'm supposed to follow in his footsteps. Okay, I'm in the under 15, so it's not league footy, but the pressure's still there. What? You're related to Lennie Lethal Weapon Lewis, everyone says when they figure out who my dad was. And the old dudes scratch their heads and say, "Yeah, sonny, I remember your grandpa, Lennie Torpedo Lewis." I suppose I should be glad people can't remember my great-grandpa, Lennie Cannon Lewis. Well, the ones who can are probably all in nursing homes. Me? Well, the coach has tried me in every position and I've already figured out where I'm best. On the bench. Lennie Lounge Lizard Lewis. The name's supposed to be lucky, see? Lennie. There's been a star footy player called Lennie in our family and it's always the firstborn male. They always wear number 9. Upside down number 6. And I'm often upside down. I feel really envious of my twin sister. She can boot a ball right across the oval and pop it through the post, no worries. She can ruck and rove with the best of them. I reckon all the footy genes crossed the placenta, swam over to my side of the womb. Jenny smirked at me one really bad day. Whatever. But whether those genes slipped sideways or went into a deep recession or dropped dead, the whole point of the matter is that she's not a Lennie. She's a Jenny. It doesn't matter if she can boot the ball across Melbourne and through the struts of the Westgate Bridge. She's not a male and she can't play league footy. And I can. Or I'm supposed to. It was programmed in my family's heads as soon as I was born. See what I mean? Lennie, what's your man? That's Grandpa. I am, I mutter as I try and catch up to him. I'm watching him. Watching him doesn't mean I can catch him or man up. I'm going to remember what the back of him looks like for the rest of my life. The opposition, a scrawny-looking hyena, fumbles the ball and by some miracle I'm right there. On that ball! Yells Dad. I scramble for it and go flat on my face, skidding along the wet grass, holding the ball to my chest. Someone does a tap dance on my spine with their boots. Someone else kneels and tries to gouge out my eyeballs. Someone else elbows me in the neck and someone else grinds their heel into my hamstring. The ump can't see because I've got two footy teams on top of me. Ball up, says the ump. Everyone gets off me. I'm trying to haul the footy out of the mud where the force of the pack has buried it. Come on, Lewis, stop mucking about, says Sherman, our cheetah ruck. He's called Sherman because he's built like a tank. Apparently the Americans had Sherman tanks in the First World War, or the Second, I don't know, some war. The ump bounces the ball. I leap up and my shorts nearly fall off, but I've tapped it away into, oh no, the opposition's arms. The hyenas are on a high and laughing their heads off. But the hyena drops it, and I'm in there with a chance like Flynn, as Grandpa would say. You can't say I don't try. Don't know who the hell Flynn is, but... This son of mine's all ticker, Dad says to his mates. No great kicker yet, mine, but all ticker. I know I'm all ticker, because it's pounding away my chest like a bongo drum. Good-hearted, that's me. If someone wants to knee me in the back or grind me into the ground, I don't take it personally. It's just the game. But I think the others do. It's payback stuff. They're kind of fired up on anger. They want to win. Me, I can see both sides of the situation. And I know one thing, both teams can't win.
Chapter 2.
One basic problem with me and footy is that I'm clumsy. The second problem, as I've said, is I'm not aggressive enough. Like, when you think about it, all the names given to footballers that I know are warlike. Great-grandpa was cannon. Grandpa was torpedo. Dad was lethal weapon. And in our team, we've got Sherman Vacchetti, Scud Zampezi, Uka the Bazooka... Don't know his last name. That's all anyone ever calls him. Ricochet Rawlings. I know that's bullets and stuff. And Hydrogen Hellas. He goes off like a bomb. But he also does huge farts that nearly blast his shorts off. Of course, we've also got some other stars like Rico and Fu and Sam and Felipe, who's in Spain at the moment because his uncle got gored by a bull. And Steve-O, when he bothers to come. And Jacko and Jamie and a few others who are pretty ordinary. While I'm thinking about all this, Scud comes in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.